grace and peace to you, friends. It's good to be able to see all of you as we gather on this Lord's Day for the worship and the praise of God. Welcome to everyone. Welcome to visitors who are here with us on this Lord's Day. If this is your first time with us, we would love for you to let us know about yourself. In fact, I'd like to invite everyone to sign the friendship pad. And if you are a visitor, we'd love to get an email address or phone number from you just so we'll know how to get in touch with you. Welcome to all on this Lord's Day. We live in a world with a lot of violence, and I know that one of the pastoral concerns today, as many of you have heard, is that we have not one but two shootings in the last 24 hours, one in El Paso, Texas, a second one last night in Dayton, Ohio. Those kinds of things inevitably are, and unfortunately, are a part of the world in which we live. Kim Herod is doing the prayers of the people later in the service, and she'll be including that as a part of the prayers this morning. Closer to home, George Bales is out of Baptist Hospital and is now at the Forum in the healthcare unit getting therapy there. The Good News to Go tells about all kinds of activities and things going on. One of those is next Sunday. After church in the afternoon, there will be a Summer's End pool party for youth, but not just for youth. It will be for anyone who wants to come and work on your tan. So stop by for a part of the thing. Some of the details are here, and you can call Carrie at the church this week. She's not here today, but we'll be back by Tuesday. And then finally, a personal word. Nancy and I returned from vacation to be surprised and pleased and gratified by an outpouring, a shower of cards that were in observance of our 50th wedding anniversary. Most of those were cards of sympathy to Nancy, which I totally get. Y'all are good folks, and we appreciate that immensely. We care for each other, and lest we needed any other proof of that, those cards to us have been that proof, and we're grateful for it. Are there any other announcements or anything?
Bill,
yes.
I remembered about the flowers.
There's some flowers, and I didn't know what they were for.
Could you turn me on? Yeah. There's flowers out here, and he said, what are they for? Because usually, you know, if we have a funeral or something, they're out there. And I said, I know, but I do remember. Those flowers are here in honor of a young couple that just came back from France for their 50th wedding anniversary.
Well, there you go.
And you can thank your daughters and their family for making that happen.
Well, that's very nice.
But you get to take those home.
Wow, I'm a little verklempt. All kind of unexpected things happen. Thank you, Sarah. We are in the presence of the Lord, friends. We're in the presence of a lot of love. Let us gather now and worship God.
Thank you.
invite you to stand in body or in spirit, and we join in our call to worship. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for the Lord is good. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. God has gathered us from all the lands. Praise the Lord. And what she does in her prayer is what we do every week. We do something here in our prayer confession that we don't do anywhere else. Most of the time we are trying to cover any imperfections, or we try to hide any sin or failures, and we try to appear that if we're not perfect, that at least we're pretty good. Here we come and we acknowledge what God and everybody else already knows, that we have turned for God and that we have hurt others. And we do that in the confidence that God is with us, loving and forgiving us. In that confidence, let us join together in our prayer. Merciful God, we come to you as we are. No hiding, no backing, no fear. We come with our love of things, our pride, our pain. Our preoccupation with status and image. We come with our image. In our response to the confession, we use the Greek words, Kyrie eleison, Lord have mercy, Christe eleison, Christ have mercy. I will sing, and then you respond. So whatever burden you bear, whatever shame you hide, whatever sin you carry, know this. There is no condemnation, literally none, for those who are in Christ Jesus. Know that you are forgiven and be at peace. And as we have received the peace of God, we do something else that we rarely do anywhere else in our world, and that is we extend God's peace to one another. The peace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Prayer of Illumination. God, our helper, show us your ways and teach us your paths. By your Holy Spirit, open our minds that we may be led with your truth and taught your will. Then we may praise you by listening to your word and by obeying it. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The reading for today is Hosea chapter 11, verses 1 through 9. God's compassion despite Israel's ingratitude. When Israel was a child, I loved him, and out of Jesus, out of Egypt, I called my son. The more I called them, the more they went from me. They kept sacrificing to the Baals and offering incense to the idols. Yet it was I who taught Ephraim to walk. I took them up in my arms, but they did not know that I heard them. I led them with cords of human kindness, with hands of love. I was to them like those who lift infants to their cheeks. I bent down to them and fed them. They shall return to the land of Egypt and Assyria, and Assyria shall be their king, because they have refused to return to me. The sword rages in their cities. It consumes their oracle priests and devours because of their schemes. My people are bent on turning away from me. To the Most High they call, but he does not raise them up at all. How can I give you up, Ephraim? How can I hand you over, O Israel? How can I make you like Admah? How can I treat you like Zeboim? My heart recoils within me. My compassion grows warm and tender. I will not execute my fierce anger. I will not again destroy Ephraim, for I am God and no mortal. The Holy One in your midst, and I will not come in wrath. Hear the word of the Lord.
Thank you. Children want to come up front? Do you have anything I can talk about today? Do you know anything I can talk about? Not a thing. No. How about you? Any ideas what I can talk about here? No. 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 Phew. At least there's not a lot of you all today. Because I got nothing. I got nothing today. I couldn't think of anything. It finally happened. It finally happened. What should we do? We got all this time here. What should we do? I won't ask Pastor Bill. He's doing everything else in the service. Nobody's got anything. Carl says nothing. How do we do nothing? Nothing. Silch. Silcho. Mm-hmm. Huh? Well, let's think of something to do. Pastor Bill's talking about Zebedee today. Do you know what a Zebedee is? Anybody got an idea? Me neither. We're going to have to pay attention during the sermon today. Yeah, maybe we'll learn what a Zebedee is. Well, let's go for a walk at least, okay? Let's go over, we're talking about window number 7 today, so let's go over there. These are 5 over here, and then we got 6 and 7. Graham and Grant, you coming with me? Let's go back here. We don't have a whole lot of time, so we'll make this trip quick here. We're using up a lot of our time here, which is good. We'll stay over here. I'm not gonna get my book over there. So we can see this window here. This window here, what do you see in that window? Yeah, you see anybody you know? Well, the three bottom pictures all have Jesus in them. Remember last week we talked about Christmas, Jesus being born, and then we got 3 more windows with Jesus in it. I guess Jesus is here, isn't he? Look at that. All that Jesus. Just when I thought I got nothing, I got Jesus. How about that? You want to talk about Jesus? When you think you got nothing, remember, Jesus is here. Jesus is with us. When you're sad or lonely or upset, remember, Jesus is watching over you here. All these windows here. How about that? We got Jesus. Okay, let's say a prayer. Dear Jesus, thank you for being with us. We love having you looking over us. Amen. Okay, thanks a lot.
Now, when Jesus heard that John had been arrested, he withdrew to Galilee. He left Nazareth and made his home in Capernaum by the sea, in the territory of Zebulun and Naphtali, so that what had been spoken through the prophet Isaiah might be fulfilled. Land of Zebulun, land of Naphtali, on the road by the sea, across the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles. The people who sat in darkness have seen a great light. For all those who sat in the region of the shadow of death, light has dawned. From that time, Jesus began to proclaim, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near." As he walked by the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon, who was called Peter, and Andrew, his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And he said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fish for people." Immediately they left their nets and followed him. As he went from there, he saw two other brothers, James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, in the boat with their father Zebedee, mending the nets, and he called them. Immediately they left the boat and their father and followed him. Again, dear friends, the word of the Lord. As far as they knew, it was going to be another ordinary day. These fishermen, two sets of brothers, Peter and Andrew and James and John, another day of heading out to the sea, another day of getting the boats and pushing off and going out to fish through the late part of the day and into the night, and then another day of, when they had come back, mending the nets of any tears that had happened because of the fishing. Then go home to get some rest, and then repeat again the same cycle that they had known forever. But on this day, something different happened. And because of what happened, their lives were never the same again. On this day, Jesus came walking down the beach, though at that point they didn't know it was Jesus. And he came to them and he spoke some simple words: "Follow me and I will make you fish for people." And immediately they dropped everything and followed him. Scholars of the Bible have long pondered, what was it about Jesus that enabled them to just leave everything like that? And you know, Matthew's gospel just doesn't say. Jesus calls and they respond. Peter and Andrew, James and John, all follow Jesus. Well, not quite all. Zebedee did not follow. Zebedee was the father of James and John. And as the others went off following Jesus, Zebedee remained behind. I wonder why. Maybe he recognized that when Jesus was speaking to call these disciples, that he wasn't speaking to him, to Zebedee. He was speaking to the young men, to Peter and Andrew and James and John, "Follow me." And so Zebedee didn't go because he was real clear that Jesus was not speaking to him, maybe. Or maybe it was that Zebedee didn't go because he just didn't know if it was something he could do. You know, if you were a young person like these two sets of brothers, you could leave and go off and do something new. But Zebedee had quite an investment here, boats and nets and all. He had a family to feed back home, so he didn't feel like he could take the risk of going off in a whole new direction. We don't need to be too hard on Zebedee, because we understand. When you're young and single, you can volunteer to be a volunteer in mission with the Presbyterian Church and go off to some country somewhere and do that kind of thing. You know, later on, you got a mortgage, and you got family to feed, and you got all these other things, and a 401k to invest in, and retirement income, and all the rest. And it's just hard to take a risk. Maybe Zebedee didn't go because he was just had too much of a stake in the kind of life that he had. And maybe there was something else. Maybe Zebedee already had some sense that following Jesus is not a walk in the park. That sometimes, in fact, following Jesus can be dangerous. I wonder if Zebedee already had a sixth sense that if you follow Jesus, and if Jesus starts talking about loving your enemies or forgiving 70 times 7, that you're liable to maybe get in trouble. Was he able to look into the future, Zebedee, and to see that these disciples would themselves suffer? In the book of Acts, it says that James, one of the four that went away, was beheaded later by King Herod. Tradition has it that Simon Peter was crucified. Maybe Zebedee didn't go because he knew it was more of a risk than he was willing to take. The Mississippi poet William Alexander Percy has a poem, some of you may be familiar with it, that talks about the dangers of following Christ. The poem goes like this: they cast their nets in Galilee just off the hills of Brown. Such happy, simple fisher folk before the Lord came down. Contented, peaceful fishermen before they ever knew the peace of God that filled their hearts brimful and broke them too. Young John, who trimmed the flapping sail, homeless in Patmos died. Peter, who hauled the teeming net, head down was crucified. The peace of God, it is no peace, but strife closed in the sun. Yet, dear friends, hope for but one thing, the marvelous peace of God. Maybe that's it. Maybe Zebedee knew that you follow Jesus, you just don't know what's going to end up happening. Sometimes following Jesus gets you in trouble. I read about a person who had volunteered to go on a mission trip at some point with the United Methodist Church and got back home and sued the Methodist Church for $5 million because they had failed to tell him that you could get in trouble on a mission trip. Well, yeah. It's not the same thing as getting a cup of coffee at McDonald's. Following Jesus is a costly thing to do. And yet Jesus continues to come to us. Follow me, he says to us, and I will make you fish for people. You give yourself as a disciple of Jesus, and it changes everything. The things that you thought were important, like getting that new outfit or buying a new car, turn out not to be so important after all. And the things that were not important suddenly become very important. Caring for the poor, showing compassion for other people, reaching out in love. Jesus changes everything. And I think about the motto of this church, making a difference by making disciples. That's nice. Jesus comes and calls us just as he called these first four disciples. And when you go and follow Jesus, it changes everything. It leads you to the most exciting, exhilarating, dangerous, purposeful life there is. You know, you put your hand to that plow, drop the thing into drive, and who knows where it will go. Following Jesus leads you to some strange places. You don't know where it'll go, but you trust because it's Jesus. And Jesus is our Lord. And we follow because we trusted him. One person who did that was Martin Luther King, Jr. Martin Luther King gave himself as a pastor, but more than that, as a disciple of Jesus. Martin Luther King, when he started out, didn't think he would end up being the great civil rights leader that we know of him to be today. Martin Luther King, in fact, grew up in a fairly middle-class situation in Atlanta, Georgia, where his father, Daddy King, was the pastor of the now-famous Ebenezer Baptist Church in Atlanta. King got a good education. He went to Crozer Seminary, and after seminary, he accepted a call to be the pastor of a Baptist church in Montgomery, Alabama. And maybe he went there thinking that he would do what pastors do, preach sermons and visit with people in the hospital and do the kinds of things that you do when you're a pastor. But one day in Montgomery, Rosa Parks refused to move to the back of the bus. And a bus boycott started, and the leaders of that boycott came to Martin Luther King and asked him to be the spokesman for it, and he agreed. And it started causing him all kinds of trouble, as much trouble as these first disciples got into. He had threatening phone calls. His house was firebombed. He was newly married and had a young, little daughter. He was worried about them. And he said one night he just couldn't sleep. And so he got up and went downstairs, sat at the kitchen table, made himself a cup of coffee, and sat there with that coffee, middle of the night. And he thought, you know, you can't call Daddy now. He's over in Atlanta. You've got to figure this out for yourself. And later, Martin Luther King told about what happened as he sat alone at that kitchen table. I discovered that night that I had to get to know God for myself. I bowed down over that cup of coffee and I prayed out loud, Lord, I'm down here trying to do what is right, but Lord, I'm weak now, I'm losing my courage. And it seemed to me, Martin Luther King says, that I could hear an inner voice saying to me at that moment, Martin Luther, stand up for righteousness, stand up for justice, stand up for truth. I heard the voice of Jesus saying, still to fight on. He promised never to leave me, never to leave me alone. No, never alone. No, never alone. So you're Zebedee, and you're standing there on the beach watching the four boys as they go off, laughing and skylarking as they follow along behind Jesus. And you're standing there and watching them go off, and a part of you is so relieved that you're not involved, because who knows what they're going to get themselves into. And you're content to stay there. But on the other hand, it's Jesus. And Jesus leads to the life that is like no other, a life of fullness and of grace and of strength. And so as you watch them, and you're Zebedee, does it occur to you to maybe just for a minute call out and say, Jesus, Jesus, can you take me too?
In response to hearing the word proclaimed, let us stand and confess the faith of the Universal Church using the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten. Came down from heaven. as we come now in continued response to God's goodness and love toward us, as we give of our tithes and offering, we will be taking a special offering today for St. Ma'am. We heard Julie Abbott speak last week about their wonderful work, and we have supported them for many, many years. So as we receive the offering today, please give joyfully.
As we come to the Lord's table, I've learned that a purse and a set of keys were left out there in the place where you signed for a name tag, and they will be over at the Welcome Center. Now, get that out of the way. We got the most important thing that we do here, and that is we come to the Lord's table. The Lord's table. He is the one who invites us to this table, and He invites you just the way you are. With your feelings of competence, but also with your feelings of inadequacy, with your strong faith, but also with your doubts, with who you are and who you wish you could be, come to the table. Jesus Christ is the one who is our Lord. We'll use the great prayer of thanksgiving, and as we did with the response to confession, when we get to the singing part, I will sing and invite you to respond. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Loving God, your mercy is like a spring that never fails.
You have sent your Son, Jesus Christ, to deliver us.
You create new heavens and a new earth. Therefore, we praise you. Joining our voices to all those in heaven and earth who forever sing to your glory.
Holy, holy, holy Lord,
who by his death redeemed us, whose ascension gives us the Spirit, great is the mystery of faith. Spirit upon us. Gather your church together from the ends of the earth. Hear now our prayers for others.
Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Loving and compassionate God, we come before you, knees to the ground, hands stretched out, and ask you to listen to our voices, listen to our cries, and listen to our pleas. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
It's not that we don't believe that you hear us, O God. It's just sometimes we need to remind ourselves that you are still there, even in the midst of chaos and suffering. Lord, in your mercy, we pray for the church, for the pastors, the staff, the pastor nominating committee, and for all who you serve in the church. We pray for this gathering of the faithful and for all who offer their worship and praise. Keep us faithful in proclaiming your word, sharing the good news of salvation, and carrying out the ministry of Christ. Lord, in your mercy, we pray for the world, for our president, for the leaders of all the nations, and for all in authority. Use us all to be instruments of your freedom, justice, and peace. We pray especially today for the shooting victims in the communities of El Paso and Dayton. Lord, in your mercy, we pray for this community. We pray for our governor, mayor, and for all in authority. Use us all to break down dividing walls. Plant and build good things among us. Lord, now more than ever, we need your assurance that your Spirit is moving in this place and in our lives. We need your wisdom, and we need your grace. Lord, in your mercy, we pray for loved ones. Watch over them with your loving eye. We pray especially for those on our prayer list. Lord, you are our hope and our strength. Hold close those who are not only broken in mind or body, but also those whose faith may be broken. Lord, in your mercy, because you have promised to hear us and are able to change us and are willing to make our hearts your home, we ask you to confront, forgive, and encourage us as you know best. Lord, in your mercy. Merciful and mighty God, hear us now as we pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
The Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and after he had given thanks, he broke it. Gave it to his disciples, saying, take, eat, this is my body, it's given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And in the same way, he took the cup and said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Pour it out for many for the forgiveness of sins. Drink of it, all of you. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Dear friends, it's for you, the gifts of God, for the people of God.
Thank you.
and let us join in praying together. You have fed us, Lord, and we are grateful. Allow us to respond this day and in the days to come with hearts made open, hands made strong, and feet made willing to do your will in this place and in all the places to which you call us. In Jesus' name. Grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit is with you and those you love this day and forevermore. And let all the people say, amen.